Welcome to Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast. This series will look behind the scenes of the forthcoming book that celebrates the making of the movie from 1980. I'm filmmaker and author John Walsh, and I will take you on a journey through time and space to discover how Flash Gordon has become one of the most iconic science fiction films in the last 40 years. I will be speaking with the cast and the crew and fans of the film and giving you an insight into the making of the book. As we lead up to the publication date in October, I will reveal details of forthcoming events, and there'll be a chance to win copies of the book too. This could be a bumpy ride, so for God's sake, strap yourselves down!
My ambition in the 50s was to create an Italian industry to make an international movie. To not do only for movie for Italian market, but to have exploitation, to have a picture successful in every place in the world, especially in the United States. This was my goal. This was my ambition. This was my dreams.
Welcome to this special, it's not special edition, it's number 5, I said, wasn't it?
Right, take 2.
Yeah. Welcome to podcast number 5 of Flash Gordon, the official story of the film. I'm joined by two very special guests who are going to speak to me today about Dino De Laurentiis and was he the last great movie mogul? So first, if I can introduce Mr. Ron Fogelman. Hello, Ron.
Hello. Hi, I'm Ron Fogelman. I'm a producer, writer, and in the past I've been a mean-spirited suit for mini majors, independent film companies, and also Universal Studios. And it was during my tenure at Universal Studios that I got to meet Dino De Laurentiis, but more on that later.
Hello, Marshall. Tell us who you are and what's your specialist subject?
My specialist subject is myself. I'm Marshall Julius. I'm a journalist and film critic. I'm the author of Vintage Geek and other things besides. I'm a social media obsessive and a total movie nerd and collector. So that's me.
Well, that's excellent. So we're here to talk about the great Dino De Laurentiis. And most people know Dino as this sort of this wonderful sort of film producer. But what a lot of people perhaps don't know is in his younger years, Dino was interested in film, of course. And there's a lovely picture of him looking very serious. I think he must have been about 8 or 9 there. And I don't know if you gents know, but Dino originally wanted to be in film, but not as a producer. He wanted to be an actor. And this is very young Dino. He looks very different, doesn't he? There's something about looking at the pictures of people when they were in their early years, in their teen years. And I think rather handsome. So I can see why he would want to be an actor. And did you guys know that he was originally wanted to be a performer and a dancer and an actor?
I've always known that, you know, you look at a picture of any young person and they look like a tattooed sailor. So I was kind of expecting that, but I had no idea. I saw something on Wikipedia about how he was trying to sell spaghetti.
I saw that as well.
Like some sort of like, it was a bit racist to say that. So
I mean, it doesn't surprise me because, you know, genuinely, if you look at the body of work, I think it's like 150 films he personally produced and was involved in 500, which, you know, I think the average producer these days is lucky if they get 5 off the ground in their entire career. You know, it's a phenomenal body of work, regardless of how many hits there were or flops there were. Just the achievement of getting something off the ground is something. And, you know, to produce that many films over, what, 7 decades in the business, that's a phenomenal career.
For all my life, I always refuse to be part of the studio. I always want to be independent. And I have to deal with my own responsibility. I have to take my risk. But the reality is, I have to follow my intuition. Wrong or right. And usually in the last 50 years of my life, my intuition was always right.
Some people don't know the difference. I mean, I'm a producer and a director and a writer, and I often get asked the question, well, what's the difference between a director and a producer? How are they different? And, you know, often the answer comes back that a producer is not involved in the creative and he's more the administrative person. But I think Dino is very different in that respect, isn't he?
Well, absolutely. I mean, you It's a hard one, because I think at the end of the day, what you should do if you're a producer or a director is you put the project first. It's about pulling off the project to the maximum. And, you know, a lot of the time there's a battle between art and commerce. You know, Dino certainly was very astute when it came to actually the finance end of putting films together and actually making them happen. But beyond that, I mean, going back to even films like War and Peace, the 1956 version, which King Vidor directed, the battle sequences were in that, where he basically mobilized armies and extras to pull off something that just would look amazing. And most people have said, you'll never get away with that. That's what producing is. You know, in a way, what you should be doing is making sure the script is right. Quite often, the script's developed before a director's on board, not always, and supporting the director to fulfill their vision of it. But I think when you're Dino, you're the one with the vision, and the director is someone that's effectively supporting that. And that's, I think, how he operated.
You know, movie industry, in my opinion, is one-man operation. I explain you why. Because the producer selects the story, select, approve the script, choose the director. Then together with the directors, make the cast of the movie. Then the producer follows the production day by day, shooting. Then he's in charge of post-production. He's in charge of the marketing. He's in charge of every process of the movie from the beginning to the end.
A lot of producers no disrespect to you guys, but people generally know the directors and the stars more than the producers. And I think that the fact that we're even talking about him means that he was a superstar producer. And even if his reach was sort of like beyond his grasp sometimes, you know, that his things were insanely ambitious. Had to totally respect that he always went for it, that he never let anything seem to daunt him. And, you know, he made a lot of great movies, made a lot of terrible movies. I mean, back to back, you've got, you know, Maximum Overdrive and then Blue Velvet, you know, like here's one and then here's the other. So it was like he totally ran the gamut of absolute kind of art house classic and absolutely the worst kind of films ever made. But, you know, when you make 500 films, it probably can't be helped, can it?
Well, you're right, Marshall. And this idea that it's the director's name above the title, it normally is, isn't it? So it's rare that we see something presented by a producer. And there's very few, there's probably you can count on one hand, producers who are known as producers predominantly. And so what did it mean for you guys when you were seeing something, whether it was in theatres or on television, and it said Dino De Laurentiis Presents, or DEG, which was one of his companies? Did you have a certain expectation about that?
The first time I came in contact with the name was as an 11-year-old in 1976, when I went to the ABC Turnpike Lane to see King Kong, which was a remake. And of course, you know, I think all of us around here, for various reasons, love the original. So even at that age of 11, trying to come up with something that would top the original was going to be hard. This was a movie with Jeff Bridges. It was big. It was bold. It wasn't quite what the original delivered. But, you know, that at a time pre-Star Wars, fantasy really being like it is today, very readily available, if you were a genre fan, you didn't really get that many films, and this was one of the biggest for the year.
King Kong, unlike anything you've ever experienced before. With Jeff Bridges, Charles Grodin, and introducing Jessica Lange as the beauty who charmed the beast. And starring the eighth wonder of the world, King Kong.
So that was the first time that I really came in contact with the name. And, you know, if you were to say to me, what do you think of Dino De Laurentiis? I often forget just the incredible body of work and the range of amazing directors that he worked with. So for me, the thing that would fire up, you know, my synapses would roll along in my brain would be King Kong, would certainly be Flash Gordon. Going back, it would be Barbarella and Danger Diabolic, and it would be those films. And I also remember him associated with a lot of films that weren't necessarily, you know, that felt like they were cashing in on a brand, like Orca the Killer Whale, which was definitely, you know, in the wake of Jaws. But as Marshall said, I mean, this is a guy who worked with some of the most amazing directors across his career. from, you know, twice with David Lynch, which you wouldn't readily think is the kind of director that you would associate with Dino. And yet he was behind two of his most ambitious films, Dune, which, you know, people have different views upon, but certainly Blue Velvet, and that was a DEG film, was, you know, a big turning point for David Lynch and a big leap of faith from any producer to get behind.
Yeah, no, definitely. I'm a big fan of Kong. Well, what about yourself, Marshall? Were you a fan of that remake?
I was never really a fan of the remake. I mean, technically, there's some great stuff in it. And just trying, you have to sort of respect just the effort of doing it. But, you know, I'm rather partial to stop motion, as you know, as I believe you are. And I don't think that many films in any genre can come close to being as good as King Kong. So I always regarded it, even when I was like six, as sort of like, but there's already a King Kong, and why are they making another King Kong? And I know it's in color, but I don't care that it's in color, because I know King Kong, I saw it on TV and it was perfect already. Now, for me, Ron said about, he often did, like films like Orca cashing in on Jaws. He also seemed to make a lot of sequels to other people's like better movies. Like he didn't make Halloween, but he made like, you know, Halloween 2, which was a pale imitation. Halloween 3, which I, you know, don't even get me started. I'm really not a fan of.
I like Season of the Witch. I think it kind of sits separately in its own little Twilight Zone bubble.
I always thought it was an incredibly nasty concept. I kind of find it sort of like sadistic about children. Having had children now, it's like I've relaxed about it more. It's like, you know, I understand, you know, you want to put a Halloween mask on and turn their head into bugs, then, you know, go for it. It's like he probably had a bunch of kids. They drove him crazy. So like Halloween 3 was like his revenge movie or something.
But not to lead down that path, let's not forget that Nigel Neill, the great creator and probably Britain's equivalent to Rod Serling, was the man behind Season of the Witch. I mean, he wrote the screenplay, although, you know, when I met him, he was he moaned a lot about how that film turned out, but he did about all the projects he was involved in. But it wasn't just Halloween, you know, in a better way. I think actually he was involved in Evil Dead 2,
yes,
and the third one, Army of Darkness. And Evil Dead 2, for me, you know, it's the first time that Bruce Campbell gets to say the words groovy, and it's a masterpiece of cinema. So the sequels thing didn't always mean that it was going to be less than
original. Absolutely. Evil Dead 2 and Army of Darkness are fantastic movies. But that's kind of the point that I made earlier, that it's like he made so many films, he got behind so many things, that just the law of averages meant that you were going to have some classics as well as some real stinkers. But for me, when the first time that I became really aware of his name as being something like significant, when you see it in the opening credits, was Flash Gordon. I was like 10 going on 11 when I saw that, and wow, that movie just kind of blew me away. I've loved Flash Gordon ever since I first saw it and went home and asked my mum what necrophilia meant, you know. That's
did she say it's a distant planet? Did she say it's a planet off of Uranus?
I went home and we actually had a guy fixing the dishwasher or something. I always seem to pick the absolute worst time. Like once I read a Wilbur Smith book and I went up to, anyway, that's another story. So
it's
yeah.
All coming out now.
So I've been a huge fan of it. And so because of voluptuous, that was the word in the Wilbur Smith. I said, Mum, what does voluptuous mean? Of course there was a guy delivering something then as well. So it's like, I really have to thank her for at least trying to expand my vocabulary. I always thought of Dino as somebody who made films like Flash Gordon, because it was the first time that I really clocked his name. And so in my mind, he's a guy who kind of worked outside the main studios, who would just like have a go and make these bigger, these larger than life, these oversaturated colors, this the way that they were played, the way that they were made, the behind the scenes stories, as well as, you know, the story that you saw playing out on the screen, was just all just so incredibly magnified. And that for me is kind of what he was. I mean, just like just amped up everything. I mean, look at, you know, Blue Velvet or Evil Dead 3 or Conan the Barbarian. I mean, those are all incredibly outrageous films that kind of stood above, or at least apart from it, you know, anything else that was out there. So for me, he was like somebody who actually made the 80s what it was. And for me, I was not interested in music or fashion or anything in the 80s. The only thing that I cared about were movies. And you know, he was a big part of that. He was a big part of kind of setting that kind of look for action, for sci-fi, for everything, really.
A spectacular journey through the wonders of space and the mysteries of time. From the boundaries of the incredible to the borders of the impossible. Now, Frank Herbert's widely read, talked about, and cherished masterpiece comes to the screen. Dino De Laurentiis presents Dune, a world beyond your experience. Beyond your imagination.
You know, I'd heard a lot of stories about Dino before I met him, and I didn't think it would go over well, you know, and I didn't think I would like being around Dino. So I went in with that in my mind, and as soon as I entered his office, even, as soon as I sat down, I felt like I was at home. It was strange, though. Well, see, on Dune, I didn't have Final Cut, so Dino was Dino 100%. You know, everyone has their own ideas of the way a film should be, and Dino is the producer that gets involved from the beginning all the way through to the end. And if you don't have Final Cut, there's not a day hardly that goes by that you're not, you know, into it with Dino. So it was a nightmare for me. I kind of died the death on Dune.
The problem with Dune, you know what is the problem with Dune? We have a fantastic movie when we did the Dark Cut. It was a 3-hour movie. And Universal, please Dino, we don't need 3 hours, we want 2 hours. Yeah! And I did the mistake to listen Universal and cut 1 hour from the movie. Immediately we cut 1 hour from the movie, it was not the same movie. We destroyed the editing room of the movie.
There was two Dinos, wasn't there? There was the European Dino working with Federico Fellini. He won the Oscar for a best foreign film for La Strada. He worked with Ingmar Bergman on The Serpent's Egg. So, and he's won Golden Globes, of course, for War and Peace in 1956. So
isn't that fascinating?
I mean, Dino, yeah. Yeah,
I mean, the thing is that actually, when you're playing at that level, from a lot of the producers that I've met, you know, you, everyone wants to label you, you know, in the business, no matter what you do, whether it's an actor being typecast or a producer basically being told he's a, you know, success maker or not a success maker. The interesting thing is that, you know, while someone may be involved in the most commercial commodity of filmmaking and perceived that way as a human being, the reality is when you get to meet these people, they're all attracted to the business because they love cinema in the first instance. And and I think that's what's really makes someone like him special, the fact that he could be someone that was a champion of auteur work that allowed, you know, even though people would moan about him, but Fellini, you know made, as you said, La Strada and Ingmar Bergman, these are incredible names, you know, and for him to, he didn't have to get involved in their films. Clearly he was attracted to their work and thought, you know, I can do something here and I want to do something here. So the fact that someone can work and successfully so with some of the greatest names in art house cinema or world cinema, and at the same time also be associated with Barbarella and Flash Gordon, that's amazing. I mean, what a career, really. We'll be right back.
I found through the research for the book, he talked about producing cinema of the fantastic came with great risks, but also great rewards. And I think Barbarella in 1968 was the first real serious attempt to do something that was fully science fiction. Of course, it's Jane Fonda looking resplendent as a very sexy space girl. And of course, there's Hawkmen in that film as well, isn't it? Yeah. John Philip Law, who's later a Sinbad for Ray Harryhausen. Yeah. And some of the technical team from that spoken to me in the book about how to make Hawkmen fly and the lessons they learned from Barbarella, because it was very heavy, heavy wings. So do all roads of Dino lead to Flash? You know, do we get the Flash Gordon we deserve because of the films that Dino has been involved in? What do we think?
I think if you, I mean, you've mentioned Barbarella and also Danger Diabolic, which are sort of heightened, very sort of Eurocentric in terms of how they've been designed. I mean, Roger Vadim was behind Barbarella, and I think Mario Bava was behind Danger Diabolic. So you've got in a way where, you know, Hollywood, most often, even though its origins actually come from Europe, most of Hollywood sort of tends to be quite, especially in that era, very focused on itself. You know, regardless of the fact that a lot of talent, especially after, you know, in the 30s and 40s, came from Europe into America for obvious reasons. But no, I think you're right. I think what was really interesting is that it wasn't just that he was one of the key moguls, but I think he was probably a trendsetter in really understanding both Europe and also how to marry talent and money from Europe with America to be able to access the American market, which is very closed door most of the time. And my background when I first entered into the film business was working companies like Rank, Polygram, and then Universal Studios in the international film business, and linking up studios and mini majors with independent distributors in each territory. And that was becoming an established business, particularly in the 80s and 90s with the rise of home video, very organized and very, very slick and professional. You know, what Dino did probably from the late 50s onwards was lay the groundwork for that whole area of how the independent business worked and how to marry an American market with access to, you know, 200 million people plus then, with money and interesting talent in Europe. I think he was a real groundbreaker in that respect.
Marshall, what do you think? You know, do you think we received the Flash Gordon because of Dino? You know, his fingerprints seem to be everywhere on every decision on that picture.
Absolutely. I think if you look at that movie, there's more Barbarella of it. There's more of the kind of European influence than there is of Star Wars. I mean, it's, you know, Star Wars is sort of like buttoned down compared to Flash Gordon, which is I think that Mike Hodges, I think that there were a lot of happy accidents. There are a lot of, you know, kind of fortunate happenings that ended up making Flash as great as it is. And I don't think it could have been made with a different producer. I think that he kind of brought an energy to it that just it made it work. Kind of,
the other thing that's really
life into it, I think.
The other thing that's really interesting is that, and you know, I know Marshall, you and I at that time, you know, we'd gone through a period being starved of genre, to then watching the impact of Star Wars, the phenomenon of it, and then so much money being charged into that particular area for knockoff clones and anything that could sort of follow on from what that film had done at the box office. So obviously, you know, in TV and certainly in Europe on the cinema, you would have Battlestar Galactica, which was very much a clone of Star Wars. You know, in its favor, we know that George Lucas had originally sought the rights of Flash Gordon, but in its favor, Flash Gordon is very much its own thing. I don't think there's anything in there that really tries to be, you know, obviously it's appealing to the audience that went to Star Wars because suddenly there was a whole revival of interest in science fiction, but it's very much its own thing. And also in terms of the things that have really stood the test of time, you know, considering the year it came in, it really helped to define what the 80s would be, you know, and that was, you know, supported by the amazing score from Queen, but also just the look of it, just from Sam Jones's hairstyle to his red T-shirt, all of it just felt, this is what the 80s is going to be like. And I think he got a lot of it right.
And because he's European as well, I think it's fair to say this, that the Europeans, because they're an older culture, are more free and open when it comes to issues around sex and sexuality. And Flash Gordon is right up there, isn't it? You know, with the outrageous behaviour and the outrageous language for a family certified film. You can't imagine an American filmmaker like George Lucas doing the same thing with that material.
No, you're quite right. I mean, I didn't go after Star Wars and ask my mum what necrophilia was. That's for damn certain.
Did she say it was a planet?
There was no, like, I mean, you know, when he's executed, he's lying in his little coffin in these incredibly brief leather shorts, and Aura kind of runs a finger along him. It's very clear that she's having sex with every man in Mongo, pretty much, for favors. She's having sex with the doctor. She just manipulates everyone. She's a total femme fatale. And there's very much, and everybody's dressed up like, you know, sort of sex dolls, but I suppose the men as well. Pretty much everyone is incredibly sexualized, except for Zarkov, thank God.
And also around that time, you know, again, in terms of marrying European talent and thinking into an American movie, I know it was Raffaella, his daughter, who formerly produced it, but he was involved in the two main Conan films that really, I think, helped, prior to Terminator, launch Arnie's career as an actor in a sword and sorcery epic, which again, I think tonally, you know, supporting John Milius and doing something different. That was all happening sort of around the same time, I think.
Dino was as tough as you could ever get. But the difference between being tough and today they'd be very tough because they're all scared and they're small. But Dino was big. He'd confront you. He had total confidence in himself. You know, he just had that killer instinct.
For me, in the way I work, I'm very straight. I'm not Machiavellic. I tell very clear to the director in the way the picture has to be done. If we disagree, goodbye, I go with somebody else. If we agree, we make the picture together.
You know, he'd say, you must do this, you must do that. And I just wouldn't listen. I'd just go do what I wanted, you know. And most of the time, I'd get away with it. But he'd always try and catch me. He'd always try and find me doing something wrong so he could have something over me, you know, so that he could threaten me with that or something like that. Then he'd tell everybody else he was going to threaten to fire me and stuff. And he was ruthless.
John loves fighting. He just likes to challenge any authority figure around him. It's just the style he has. And of course, Dino loves it too. And now the two of them are like fighting every day. You know, it's like the typical who's got the bigger dick thing. Can you say that on television? Yeah, well, that's what was going on every day on Conan.
Well, I fight all the time when I see something is wrong. But always we come an agreement and we decide for the best of the picture, this is the best way to move.
So he said, if you make this movie a hit, I give you a golden sword. The Bulgari make you a golden Conan sword. So as the movie was a hit, I said, where's my golden sword? And he went, there's your golden sword. That's Dino.
One of the goals of a producer is to pick the A-team, and it's incredibly hard to get a director that you're going to be in sync with and can support and make 1 + 1 = 3 to find the right material to develop in the first place, and then to put a team of all of the creatives that sit behind it, from set design to music. You know, that's like, you know, any football manager finding the right team to play with, and it's alchemy. It's very hard to do. And, you know, it didn't always get it right, but certainly in these instances, certainly in the case of Flash Gordon, he most certainly did.
Mm-hmm. But I'm going to pick you up on that, Ron, because if we were talking in December 1980, when the film premiered, the 8th of December, and my new book, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film, which comes out at the end of the year, coincides
with
that.
You've written a book, John.
I've written a book. I didn't want to tell anyone. I was trying to do a Banksy and keep it all...
No, tell us.
Yeah. Well, I don't like to. Not a blush, but it's my second book. And you may have seen the first book, this lovely one. As I say, I've tried to keep my name out of it, but I can now reveal that I actually did. It is me. I'm that John Walsh.
It's all coming together now. Suddenly, everything makes sense. My journey to this very point in time just now makes complete sense.
Is that the actual size of the book, though? Because I think I've got a smaller version.
But John, in my mind, you're bigger than the book.
It's very kind of you to say. It's very kind of you to say. So if this was 1980 and we were talking about Flash Gordon coming out, we'd be talking about why it didn't work, why it didn't punch through, what the failures were, why it's not going to have a sequel.
Well, if I'm correct, again, this is the interesting thing about the international business, is that I don't think, for Marshall and my experience, because we were first-time customers at the door probably the day it opened. In fact, I don't know why. I worked for the company that owned Odeon, but then clearly I saw King Kong at the ABC Turnpike Lane and I saw Flash Gordon at the ABC Enfield, cinemas that have now long gone. But the reality is, I believe, the UK is an incredibly supportive territory for genre, more proportionally than most markets. And I believe the film was very successful here, although it didn't necessarily perform the way you'd want in the very hard to navigate US market. So our perception of it is most certainly that this was a hit and it was everywhere. But I think you're right. If you looked at the overall performance of the film, particularly America, it may not have landed the way that would have been hoped at that time.
I'm curious, did it come out before or after Empire Strikes Back?
After. So Empire had already opened, so had Superman 2. So this is the landscape for 1980. Empire Strikes Back, the second Star Wars film. Superman 2, the second Christopher Reeve film. To Saturn 3 and The Final Countdown. So a Kirk Douglas double bill there. So Flash
and we
Gordon's,
saw them all at the cinema, which is,
which is fabulous. So I got to be honest, when I saw The Empire Strikes Back the first time, it was a little bit slow for me. I was still quite young and it was not like Star Wars. There was more romance. There was more sort of philosophy. There was more standing around talking. And yes, obviously I love it and it's insanely good. And, all that other stuff, when I was a kid and when I was small, when I first saw it, I remember being a little bit disappointed. And when I saw Flash Gordon, I was like, oh yeah, this is more like it. I think for sure I like Flash Gordon more than The Empire Strikes Back. And
similar. I went to the European premiere of Empire Strikes Back at the Odeon Leicester Square, which had all of the cast there. It was a lucky hit for myself and a friend called Paul, where we managed to get tickets in the stalls from the charity. And I remember they cost £5, which even then was a lot of money for us.
You've literally been showing off about going to that screening for 40 years, and
I'm not going to stop. And it was a great evening, but I digress. I think we've gone off the message, but it was certainly when I saw Empire Strikes Back as well, I loved it. There was such expectation for it, but that I was just going, well, I love bits of it. Some of it really works really well, some of it's not so good. Some of the special effects, as if you can remember back to how it looked originally, weren't necessarily as flawless as the original movie. But since then, look, this is what happens, Marshall. We grow, we mature, then we recognize. And actually, this week, I'm not sure where the podcast goes out, but this week it's number one at the UK box office in these strange times of lockdown. Which, okay, there's no other films being released, but that's quite an achievement 40 years old, albeit through the most strangest of circumstances.
Which is that? But also, Empire Strikes Back is number one, is it?
Yeah, back on the top of the charts this week. But I think that, already by 1980, we were getting inundated with quick knockoffs of cheap knockoffs of the film that we loved the first time round. Empire certainly wasn't that. It was a deserved sequel, and in looking at it as we grow up, realize how great that movie is. But Flash Gordon, I agree with Marshall. It was its own thing. It didn't. It commercially recognised that the time was right to make a Flash Gordon movie because an audience had been proven in a way that it hadn't been before for a science fiction movie, but equally it didn't say right we're gonna carbon copy this and make it sort of exactly the same thing. It is very much its own movie.
We were familiar with it anyway from all the Buster Crab serials. I mean, Flash Gordon was a property that we were all well aware of, and as we were, hey, there you go. I mean, so, like every summer holiday, they would trot out, there would be loads of like Laurel and Hardy shorts. There would be Tarzan movies. There would be, and they would show the Buster Crabbe serials. And so I watched all of those. And it was like before Star Wars was even a thing. I used to love the Flash Gordon serials, the spaceships, the design of it, the adventure of it.
But those serials, though, they were kind of melodrama. And so I do wonder, I've got a shot here of Dino. This is quite a rare shot to show you, lads. And this is him on set during the making of the film. And he's there on the Ming sets. And he's looking a little bit kind of concerned. And when he used to go to rushes where you'd see the footage, or dailies, as they call it, he was concerned that tonally it had more humour than certainly the serials ever had. The serials were just straight melodrama. There was very little in the way of knowing winks to camera. The serials weren't tongue-in-cheek.
None of that. It wasn't camp at all.
Exactly. So this idea of it being comic and or camp was something that Dino wasn't expecting. And this look on his face here is somebody who's looking like, hang on, this has cost more than The Empire Strikes Back, more than Superman 2. In fact, it was the most expensive film of that year, costing somewhere in the region of $35 million. And when we think the following summer, Ray Harryhausen had his most expensive film, Clash of the Titans, costing $15 million, you somehow see how much Flash Gordon costs. So expectations must have been very high. Is he disappointed here, do we think?
I think, you know, if you're producing, it's one of the hardest skill sets that you need in the world. It's, you have to understand production, finance, distribution, you know, how to work with writers and directors to get the best off the page. You have to understand talent, and therefore you have to understand psychology. And getting all of that right, it's very rare for a human being to really get the chance to excel in more than one or two of those fields, and you have to do everything. Every single one of them has to be played to the max to pull off a film that's going to be great, especially one as so technically challenging as Flash Gordon. So I don't think one photo of Dino sitting there in the maelstrom of cinema really reflects what his mood was during the film. I certainly know from doing research, and John, you know, you've done a much deeper dive on this, but you know, I think there were sort of, you know, concerns as to how much humour and how much comedy should be in the film. But then again, if you look to who was one of the screenwriters on it, which is Lorenzo Semple Jr., you're talking about someone that was behind the original amazing and brilliant, you know, camp defining Batman TV series in 1966. Yeah. So the expectation of there being something in there along those lines, you know, must have been there from the outset when Dino pulled him into the project.
Also, look at the set he's sitting on. It's bright red and gold. That film was as camp as Christmas from the moment they walked onto the set. There is no way you walk onto that and think, oh, yeah, this is like, you know, Fellini's Flash Gordon. This is not. This was crazy stuff from the start. And I think what Mike Hodges did was that he kind of recognized that, and he just knew how to make it work. Although, you know, they just made it up as they went along, and it was just really good luck, because a lot of films that you make up as they go along do not work.
Well, Dino put all the senior people in their kind of department roles. So Danilo Donato, who was both the costume designer and the production designer, so created the sets and the look, he originally wanted to put Flash Gordon in a Diamondique version of this T-shirt that I'm wearing and leather hot pants for the whole picture. And Mike Hodges was like, nah, that's not happening. He went and saw one of the tests. I've tried to find photos of it. We have a lot of photos in the new book, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film. And you can see a lot of these pictures for the first time. But a line had to be drawn somewhere. And as you say, that the outrageousness of it looks like it could be a Christmas display in a shop window, you know, in a glamorous department store from the 70s, isn't it?
John, I've got to say that this is complete news to me that there's a new book about Flash Gordon, which you've just mentioned. Tell me, can I go out and buy that book right now from bookshops?
Is it available from all good bookshops?
It is.
Some bad ones.
All the bad ones have it out the back. By the bins. No, they don't have it by the bins, of course. It was at the time we're recording this, it's number one on Amazon for hot picks of new films and a new film book. So beating Mandalorian into number two, and there's a thing with a Baby Yoda on it at number four. There's like, when you look at movie books for science fiction films, if they're not Blade Runner, Alien or Star Wars, they're not there. So this is the first time a book's ever been allowed to be made on Flash Gordon.
And yet I don't have a copy. When will I be able to get my own copy?
On the, it's very kind of you to ask, Ron. On the 27th of October, of course, you gents will be getting your copies, hopefully in advance of that, so you can have a preview and a review.
I'm really looking forward to it.
And, you know, the book itself is like the film in that it took me longer to get the rights to get the book published and get the deal with Titan Books through King Features, who are the rights owner. And we work very closely with them on that. And Studio Canal, of course, have got the film itself, the physical assets. So it took longer to put that deal together than it almost took to write the book. And I know Dino had a similar situation when he was putting the film together. It took longer to raise the finances. And when he got the money, he then had to run.
That's crazy. A common view. And you know, I mentioned it in the outset, but one of the things I've been involved in was the stage production of The Twilight Zone, which is it took me 3 years to get the rights to convince CBS that the approach we were going to take was the right thing to you know, for the project. And that's very much a part of what the producer has to navigate through. Quite often you have to sit with, you know, rights owners of original properties, estates. A lot of time people are champions or guardians of original material, or they just don't have the time to really take on, you know, unless the money is significant enough, you know, an inquiry about a license of that. So that's certainly one of the things that, yeah, as you look through his career, he became the master at, which is securing IP. In a way, as we know, that George Lucas, even after the success of American Graffiti, which we forget here in Europe was a phenomenal blockbuster hit in America, even after that, he wasn't able to get the rights. So, you know, let's hats off to Dino. He got rights that George Lucas couldn't get.
Mm. And on lots of other books as well. You know, think Stephen King books. He did The Dead Zone and got David Cronenberg to direct.
But that's another amazing director. I mean, I think The Dead Zone's a great film. It's got Martin Sheen and Christopher Walken and probably, you know, one of the best Stephen King adaptations. That being said, of course, he is responsible for producing Maximum Overdrive, directed by Stephen King, which doesn't quite come up to the mark. Although it has a very, very good trailer in which Stephen King promises that he's going to scare the hell out of us.
Hi. My name is Stephen King. I've written several motion pictures, but I want to tell you about a movie called Maximum Overdrive, which is the first one I've directed.
Wow. What in the dickens is going on around here?
A lot of people have directed Stephen King novels and stories. And I finally decided if you want something done right, you ought to do it yourself. I'm going to scare the hell out of you.
Dino De Laurentiis presents Stephen King's Maximum Overdrive.
He described the movie as a movie for morons. So, like, he kind of stopped short of really giving it excellent publicity, didn't he?
But
I tried to watch Maximum Overdrive like last month. I tried really hard because I only saw it once on VHS, you know, like when it first came out. But I couldn't get through it.
I mean, the only thing that's really stands out about that film is the Green Goblin, truck vehicle. That looks cool. And then when you saw that, you went, all right, this is before all the Spider-Man movie adaptations. So you're just thinking, all right, I want to see the movie just because of that. But then when you saw the movie, it was like, oh dear. But, you know, look, you know, it's so hard to just get a film produced and get it off the ground. So I have respect for most people, even if they don't do a good job of it, that they actually said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to get the money together. I'm going to get it done and I'm going to get it completed. You know, the fact here, though, as we've said before, is that, you know, in 86, he did Blue Velvet. You know, in the 70s, some of the bodies of work he did was fantastic, working with directors like Milos Forman, with Sidney Lumet, with Sidney Pollack. You know, films like 3 Days of the Condor, films like Serpico, Death Wish. Mm. You know, all real sort of very interesting. Even, you know, sometimes you may look back at them and go, they weren't as good as they were the day you saw them, but they're still really important, significant films.
Well, they set a tone. There's a reason that people think that, you know, the 70s was like a golden age for cinema, and those films, the kind of taut, quiet, very deliberate sort of thrillers, wonderful scores, great performances. I mean, and I think that, yeah, I mean, you maybe have to be a bit more patient with them today, but they're still excellent movies.
So, Ron, can I ask you, out of the three of us, you're the only one who's actually met Dino. I've spoken to Martha extensively for this new book, but how did you get to meet him? It was in a professional capacity, wasn't it?
Yes, I mean, as I said, in the early phase of my career, I was involved in the international sale of movie rights, and you know, a lot of people don't really they tend to view the fact that there's Warner Brothers and there's Disney, and that basically they say, right, we're going to greenlight the movie and it's all done in one package. Whereas what's classed as the independent side of the business is, it has producers who can't necessarily, you know, get their films greenlit by studio, piecing together in a kind of patchwork quilt a film with finance from all over the world. And one of the mechanisms for that is international sales, where effectively you hope you're going to get a US distributor, and you're also going to get significant monies coming from certainly the key territories, but ultimately the rest of the world to make movies happen. And in the 80s, in particular, when Dino set up DEG, which was the De Laurentiis Entertainment Group, you know, that was running off the back where VHS had suddenly allowed a whole new level of finance and re-energizing of the cinema business. It did two things. When home entertainment started in late 70s, a lot of the people in the film industry were worried. They felt it was going to cannibalize the cinema, and it was, you know, it was going to be doing even more damage than what TV did. In fact, it was the opposite. First of all, it allowed the consumer to watch movies when they wanted to, how they wanted to, and created a whole new wave of interest in cinema. And also, to a degree, that interest resulted in education. So people started to talk about directors and who, you know, they were able to watch, you know, consistently a whole body of work within a few days. So the international sales business energized itself in the 80s, and that's where you saw a real blooming, a blossoming of a lot of companies outside of the studios themselves making movies. That resulted in Dino cashing in on that, setting up a studio himself, setting up DEG and making the movies like Blue Velvet at that time. One of the movies that he did in 1986 was Manhunter, which I was able to see when it came out at Grauman's Chinese Theatre in Hollywood, the place where you see all of the footprints and handprints and cement. And I went by myself as I was traveling around and went to see this movie, not having read any of the books by Thomas Harris, not knowing anything about it other than it had just been released that week, and was blown away by the performances, the story, and particularly Brian Cox's first originating performance of Hannibal Lecter. And that film has an interesting story because in the UK, its release was delayed. I think at that time, DEG was starting to have financial problems. There were distribution problems. It hadn't performed in America, and it kind of just escaped in the UK. Most people had never even heard of the movie here. And yet, the power of it and the power of Lecter was very clear. And then, you know, a few years later, I was he'd not taken up the option to make Silence of the Lambs because I think the disappointment of Manhunt at the box office. So he didn't. He retained the underlying rights to the franchise, but he didn't produce Silence of the Lambs, which became a phenomenal hit and, of course, an Oscar-winning film and a career-defining role for Anthony Hopkins. After that, of course, the film was phenomenal. And the sequel was certainly planned, and Dino, you know, was all over it. And there were attempts to try and get it going soon after Silence of the Lambs, but it didn't happen. I mean, you know, I remember sitting in on meetings with, when my company, Rank, my first company, which had released the film in the UK, they were trying to get the rights because it had been a phenomenal success. And, they met with Dino De Laurentiis and his lead sales agent at that time. And, you know, the money that he was asking was phenomenal. And for whatever reason, it just didn't go. And I think that has much to do with Anthony Hopkins. Jump forward a few years, and I was then working at Universal Studios as the Senior Vice President of International Sales and Development. And at that time, you know, Universal had just acquired the company I'd worked for, Polygram. It had not had a good few years. It was finding it hard to, you know, really deliver the kind of slate it needed to deliver on the production dollars it had available. It had a number of flops behind it. And it was actually really just about to turn its fortunes. This is 1999, where suddenly after about 2-3 years of not really delivering hits, it had a great summer with The Mummy and Notting Hill, and suddenly started to really turn around. And also Gladiator. And in that in that period, that's when Dino really got Hannibal, the sequel novel which Thomas Harris had written and which he'd optioned because he had the right to. He was getting that off the ground, but even then, Universal, the budget was high. The fees were ridiculous. It was Ridley Scott whose back-end deal was maxed out because Gladiator had been such a phenomenal hit. So at that time, there was a thing called gross profit participation, and it meant that the talent behind the film, including, you know, Ridley Scott, Dino, Anthony Hopkins, there was a lot of money going out even before it would recoup, to because that was the profit entitlement that these major people involved in the project were allowed. So this was coming together. The studio wasn't, you know, as successful as it had been or was about to be. And so therefore what it thought it would do is use the skill set that I'd had to sell some of the territories off, to unload some of the costs, pull in some money through what's called minimum guarantees. So you're reducing your production spend commitments and, you know, hopefully hedging your bets. And at the other side of the coin is that you're not committed to some of the phenomenal print and advertising spends that were in place at that time. So I'm probably speaking out of turn now, but I remember we did the deal for Japan and we sold it for $14 million, the rights for Japan, just for Hannibal, for $14 million. Which of course takes off some of the pressure on the production budget of the film. And equally, I think the prints and advertising spend in Japan, which in that era was the number two market in the world after the USA, it was phenomenal. Just to release it would have cost the distributor $12 million. So that's significant, like $25 million worth of relief in terms of your production commitment, which you could then spend on other films. It was a way of basically the studio offsetting risk. And we sold Japan, Italy and Germany, I think, were the top three territories that were sold for the project. And Dino was very much involved in that. So I ended up going to his house, which is very nice, and meeting Martha and sitting with Dino, who was very much hands-on, again, an indication of him not just being on the set, sitting on steps, wondering why a film was 3 days behind, but also the fact that he was involved even in looking at every square inch of the who the film was going to be sold to, in which market, what was their commitment to distribution, how are they going to release the film, this is before it's even made. All of those are sorts of the questions and cross-examination that he would make in a very delightful way. He was a very charming man to distributors that were hoping to acquire the rights to what was looking to be a big blockbuster. And so, you know, we would sit and we met with a series of people from Japan, from Italy, from Germany, and throughout the day. And I remember one in particular. If you remember, Hannibal didn't reunite the whole cast because Jodie Foster didn't return as Clarice Starling. And some of the distributors were, you know, the game is that you will say whatever you can, even though you know you really desperately want the film, and it's obvious you do, but you'll have to say certain things that hope will help you negotiate the price down. So all of them seized on the only opportunity, which was that, okay, you've got Ridley Scott and he's just off of Gladiator, so we can't attack that. You've got Anthony Hopkins, he won the Oscar, and everyone was doing the Hannibal Lecter impression of, you know, I had his liver with some fava beans and a fine Chianti. So you couldn't knock that. So what was the weak point you might be able to help to negotiate? And that was that Jodie Foster wasn't returning. And so in his very sort of charming way, he just, you know, it wasn't going to open up any chance to negotiate, because he just turned around and said, hey, the film is not called Clarice, it's called Hannibal. And, you know, and he did it in a way where, you know, straight away, anyone that was trying to negotiate with him just knew it wasn't going to happen and they were going to have to pay up. And it was amazing to sit with him at that time, and obviously with his lawyer, and I think it was the guy called Rick Finkelstein, who was the president of Universal, and sort of be involved with someone of that nature in the middle of negotiations for what was going to be a blockbuster of a film, as it was in 2001 when it was released. So that was my experience of sort of working with him, and it was fun. He was a great character, but super smart, and he's handled absolutely everything.
Dino knows his place in the film history. He knows how clever he is, and he knows that he doesn't need anyone, and that's his strength and his power. He doesn't need that. You know, with all due respect to Hollywood, they need him.
Hello.
Is this Clarice? Well, hello, Clarice.
I've been in a state of hibernation.
I need some action, Clarice. I need to come out of retirement and return to public life.
I couldn't help noticing on the FBI's rather dull public website that I have been elevated to the more prestigious 10 most wanted list. Is this coincidence, or are you back on the case?
I have information about Animal Lecter.
You're trying to catch him yourself, aren't you? He killed three policemen while in custody. Tearing the face off one of them, and he will kill you too.
Are you by any chance trying to trace my whereabouts? You naughty girl.
How long can a man stay silent before he returns to the thing he does best?
I'm giving very serious thought to eating your wife.
Academy Award winner Anthony Hopkins. Academy Award nominee Julianne Moore. In a Ridley Scott film. Hannibal.
I think Marshall's itching to do his Hannibal Lecter.
I want to know if you geeked out with him at any point and
I
asked
want to
him
ask
about
that. Yeah,
did you... or asked him about Flash Gordon or...
Or Dune or anything.
I wish I would have done, but, you know, I was a, you know, as anyone is at that sort of point, you know, all the things you want to do, which you hope you can do, you have to wait for the right time. And I've been lucky to be able to do that with some people and ask all sorts of questions and get some of the dirt on their careers and be told all sorts of the trivia that you and I really love. But no, my experience working with him for a very limited time, but on a very, you know, in the whirlwind of trying to get a film set up and away and financed appropriately, you know, I was very much seeing his business mind at work. And so therefore that I wish I could have said, you know, what was it like to work with Jane Fonda and Barbarella, or, you know, how was Mike Hodges to work with on Flash Gordon? Sadly, that opportunity wasn't allowed, but in seeing how his mind works and how he could, you know, you have to be charming. You have to be able to sort of take, you know, parry with some of the smartest brains in film distribution and financing and still end up with you know, on top in terms of the deal that you do. It's a complex business. You know, in terms of the negotiation, it's not like going to market with some fish. You are the licensing deals that sit behind them have complex financial structures sitting behind them. You're setting up a structure that involves all rights, usually, for those kinds of deals, which means the theatrical release, the home entertainment release, which at that time was the when the DVD market was emerging, TV, but that was also now becoming pay TV and regular TV. And you've got to structure different deal terms for all of those things and make sure that the whole deal works and you're getting the money through. And to add to that, I think that 30% of the gross was out on that film, which meant that very early on in the life of the film, as money was coming in, 30% of every buck that came in was going out to talent because it was, you know, it was the only way to get the film made. And we had to pass that on to the independent distributors, and that was not done at the time. So it was kind of a one of the first films that was accepted on that basis by the independent world.
Well, one of the first questions I asked Martha for the book was, what did Dino think about this film, that film, and so on? And the overriding opinion that came back, she said to me, was that, you know, Dino, when he'd finished a project and moved on to something else, he was focused on that next project. So didn't really live in the past and didn't really think about previous projects. So I said, you know, how would he think 40 years on now about Flash Gordon being a success? And she said he probably wouldn't be delighted because he no longer had an interest in the picture and no longer had a legal interest in it. And so it's a library title that he no longer owns. So now that other people are gaining, if you like, from his blood, sweat and tears, is not necessarily something you could rejoice. So that was a sanguine answer, I guess.
I think,
so you think in an artistic capacity, though, that he would be just happy to have been involved in something that has endured.
No, because I'm a producer and a director, and that part of me is just like, I'm trying to think of a parallel in history I won't mention, but you know, you cannot separate your anger from somebody taking your project from you and then them going having a success with it. If anything, it's the knife being twisted. There are some directors who'd sooner burn their negative than let somebody else make money from their blood, sweat, tears and debt that they maybe got into. I do accept what you're saying, Marshall, that, you know, I think if you're just on board as an artist and you've not been on board setting it up, because it's like setting up a company, you literally have to set up a limited company and go through all of the kerfuffle of running a business for a year or two while you make the project. If you're the artist who didn't really get paid, but you've had some success, reflected success from it, I'd say yes. But if you're a producer, they're a certain type, aren't they? Ron, you know, I don't think.
Well, there's so many. I mean, you know, on one hand, you've got the term producer. I think it should be a licensed activity where you need to, you know, just like a doctor or a lawyer, you need a certain degree of training. That's lovely, by the way, Marshall. But the trouble is that a lot of people call themselves producer, and that's because they've got a business card and a mobile phone. And, you know, there's so many people that you meet that are cowboys, just like in the building trade. There's some people that know how to put up a great building. There's some that you just don't want to walk in the front door of because they just don't know what they're doing. I think that one of the things that's common is that, John, you're a producer, Marshall, you work in entertainment too, and you'll understand that whatever you do, yes, it's fantastic when a lot of people take great pleasure and enjoyment, and that it's also a commercial success as well, and that people look back and go, that was an amazing film, and, you know, and it enters the annals of fame. But a lot of the time, I think it's quite a sad life, because all that you can see is what's wrong with it. You know, if you're a director, John, and you've made your film, you know, you're going to be a perfectionist. You have to be if you're going to do something good. And you'll realize that bit doesn't work quite the way you wanted to, or I had to cut this for time. And, you know, and I think that's probably going to be part of how Dino's makeup would be, which is that, you know, he'll recall the, you know, how much the film didn't make, the fact that the license ran out within the next period of time. You know, he'll remember the grief that he got on the day of the set. Yeah, of course there's joy wrapped up, and it's a great success when you walk on a red carpet and your film is going out there for the first time. But it's a complicated existence. I would have thought that any project, even the most successful, carries mixed feelings.
So this book now, just to close things up, the full story of how the film was made, what happened, the problems people had. There was obviously a dispute or a fight, if you like, between Sam Jones, who played Flash Gordon, and Dino. All of that now, for the very first time, is going to be answered in this book. And it will be, I don't think there's going to be another book. You know, this Flash Gordon license is for a limited period only, for this once in a lifetime book that's coming out. What do you hope to read in the book? You know, what questions do you have that remain unanswered about how it was made or what the process was?
I'm interested to see how all those disparate elements came together. You know, I'm interested to see how a director who was at odds with the producer, who was at odds with the actor, they wanted it to be like a serious science fiction epic, but on the other, they got the writer of Batman 66 to do it. How somehow all of these really odd ingredients from all around the world, American, Italian, English, all these different sensibilities, how that all just kind of boiled down into one film that I just kind of love, like life itself, how it just turned out to be such an incredibly colorful, vivacious, funny, exciting, and not at all dated. Honestly, I watch it today and it is as good, if not better, than it was then. There is genius in it, and maybe some of it was accidental genius, but I'm looking forward to learning kind of how all those, you know, how all those different elements came together, because it just seems like some sort of alchemy, you know, just some movies. You read a lot of making of stories, and often when people have a good time making film, the film turns out to be just terrible. You know, it's actually, you should be worried if you're making a film and you're enjoying it too much. Sometimes it's the one where the struggles and nobody really knows what's happening. I mean, you know, Star Wars, nobody really thought that was going to be successful. Nobody saw the effects until, you know, late into the game. They were doing it. They had no idea what they were making. And I think probably there was a lot of grief and worry in behind the scenes in Flash Gordon as well. But they needn't have worried. You know, here we are 40 years later and we're still talking about it.
What about yourself, Ron? What questions do you have?
Very similar to Marshall. I mean, first of all, you set the bar very high, John, with Harryhausen and the Lost Films, which I have read cover to cover and thoroughly enjoyed. I think that Marshall and I have discussed this endlessly, that the, you know, a really good making of book, and you know, some are great, some are okay. But for me, you know, when I was a kid, I liked to take a wristwatch and open up the back and see how the mechanism worked. And that was a point of fascination. And with a good making of book, seeing the behind the scenes, seeing all of the sort of struggles, the wins, the losses, some of the things, the complicated stories and anecdotes that you just don't normally associate with a film that you've been in love with for years, suddenly come out and you get a whole new perspective on what went into the making of the film. So I've got every confidence that what you're going to deliver with the Flash Gordon book is going to hit the high notes of what you deliver with Harryhausen and answer all the questions as how did the film Flash Gordon come to be. I can't wait.
Yeah, you know, I've interviewed a lot of the cast members and behind the scenes people over the years. I interviewed Howard Blake for his, you know, Snowman albums, but the first thing I wanted to talk to him about was about Flash Gordon. I interviewed Mike Hodges for, I can't even remember the name of the film. First thing I wanted to talk to him, Flash Gordon. I interviewed Topol again, had no idea, I can't remember Flash Gordon. I met several members of the cast and crew over the years, and I have no recollection of what I was supposed to be talking to them about, because like 80% of what I always wanted to talk to them about was Flash Gordon. It's like one of those movies like Jaws that is fabulous and also fascinating behind the scenes, you know, amazing behind the scenes stories. And I know from the conversations that we've had, John, over the last year, and the little kind of tidbits that you've thrown my way, that this just book is going to be absolute full of gems, and it will absolutely be exactly what every Flash Gordon fan is hoping for. And I hope our checks are in the mail now.
They certainly are, and I hope the 40 years has been worth the wait. We have the stories, and more significantly, we have the images, shots that people didn't think had been taken in colour of the sets, the deleted scenes, what could have been, the original director's vision, Nicholas Roeg, because we didn't talk about him today. But perhaps you gents could come back when the book is out and tell me what you really think.
No, I would love to. I remember seeing it in 1980 thinking the only thing that's missing is a really cracking making of book. And finally, it feels like that gap in my life is about to be filled.
Yeah, one of the first making of books actually I got to end the note about Dino was the King Kong making of book, which was from a publisher called Star. You know, there weren't that many making of books in 1976. You could get the making of Star Trek, you could get making of Doctor Who, that was about it. And that was one of the first volumes. And I was just fascinated because, you know, it was my opportunity to understand how the business worked. And yet when Flash Gordon came out, that, you know, it wasn't there. So now the wait for 40 years is finally at an end and we get to see how that machine worked.
Well, Marshall Julius and Ron Fogelman, thanks very much.
But you know, many producers believe the most important thing in make a movie is the money. Nothing's more wrong than that. You need the idea. If you have the right idea, the money comes always to you. And I can prove through all my life, from the Bible to War and Peace to La Strada, to Serpico, to Tresco, when you have the right idea, the money you find at any place you want.
What plaything can you offer me today?
The planet Earth.
What's happening?
It's an attack.
Pathetic Earthlings, who can save you now?
Let's all team up and fight him.
Prepare for torture!
I want him.
Stop at nothing.
Flash, I love you! But we only have 14 hours to save the Earth!
Flash Gordon is still alive.
Gordon's alive?
My lucky day.
Copyright in Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast, is owned by John Walsh and Titan Books Limited, under license from King Features Incorporated. Audio from the film is courtesy of Studio Canal. This recording may not be reproduced in whole or in part without written permission from us. The views expressed within these podcasts do not necessarily reflect those of the associated companies or its employees. For further terms and conditions, please contact us at our Facebook page, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film.